My plan is to go over these two topics, and depending on the questions asked, I think we have an excellent shot at finishing them within about an hour and a half, which would leave an hour for Q&A if anyone brought some questions in advance. And that means we might be able to do a little less on Thursday and finish earlier so you can get some sleep, which is important when you do a final, believe it or not. Before I begin with those two topics, are there any general questions that anyone has? Nothing? Okay, in that case, quadratic forms. And if this has nothing to do with Geo210, then that's where you're supposed to go.
Or it should.
Okay, so we're dealing, this is a section on symmetric matrices. So this is part of B, symmetric matrices, this is what I call it. And just as a tiny bit of review of the review, summary of the spectral theorem first, because we'll need it, and it's important. This is not a complete treatment. I did that at the end of last Thursday's session, so if you missed it, the video, I think, is online. Anyone confirm that? Yes, yeah, it's up. But just to summarize the spectral theorem, if A is symmetric, which you should recall means A transposes A, if A is a symmetric matrix, by definition square, then it is possible to write, you can write, A is SDS inverse. So it's diagonalizable, but in particular, S is orthogonal. Which in particular also means that S inverse is S transpose. Notice the difference between symmetric and orthogonal. It doesn't seem like quite much, just a little minus one, but they're completely different. They're completely different. So, in fact, symmetric matrices need not be invertible. For instance, the zero matrix. Matrix is all zeros. It's certainly symmetric, but it's not invertible. So there's the thing, and of course, ND is diagonal.
Orthogonal means length 1 as well, right?
Well, an orthogonal vector means that an orthogonal pair of vectors have dot product 0. Orthogonal vector by itself doesn't mean length 1. Normal means length 1. You're confusing orthogonal with orthonormal.
Orthogonal matrix is made of orthonormal vectors?
An orthogonal matrix satisfies this, and its columns or rows are an orthonormal basis of Rn. Yes, that's one of the characterizations of orthogonal matrices. It's an unfortunate fact that there's the same word or same adjective, orthogonal, applied to a pair of vectors and a matrix. And the pair of vectors, orthogonal, just means right angles to each other. And right. But the matrix is a little more sophisticated, but nevertheless, it's related. Okay. So this is the spectral theorem, and now we're going to see how to use it. In particular, it has a number of uses, but one big use is quadratic forms. So that was the summary of one, what I call one. I'm just continuing my numbering scheme of the whole post-midterm part of the course. Section two is quadratic forms. All right, here's what I think you need to know about that. So first of all, you need to know what a quadratic form is. So as far as we're concerned, you have a function that could be Q or F or some letter, and it's a quadratic function, a homogeneous quadratic function in the variables x1, x2, up to xn. So this is a quadratic, so that's degree 2, homogeneous, which means that every term is degree 2. There's no linear or constant terms. Function of x1, up to xn. It's a linear combination of precisely two types of terms. One, the diagonal type of terms, diagonal, x1 squared, x2 squared, up to xn squared, and the cross terms, which would be x1, x2, x1, x3, and so on up to x1, xn. So those are all cross terms involving x1. But you also have cross terms that don't involve x1, say involve x2. X2, xn, up to x2, x2, x3, up to x2, xn. So let's just stare at this for a second. There we go. It's hard to do this in general, of course. So you have x1, x2. Why do I not do x2, x1? Well, because I've already got x1, x2. So I don't need to duplicate that. You know, x1, x2, the product of those two variables is the same as x2, x1. So I just start at 3, actually. I don't need x2, x2 again. So of course I have x3, x4, and so on, etc., up until you get to xn minus 1, xn. So it looks ugly in that sort of generality, but basically you can have any square of one of the variables, and you can have any pair of the variables, but you cannot just have an x1 by itself, or a constant, or anything like that. That wouldn't be a quadratic form. Okay, so the connection, I'm only going to use the top board of this, just because of the lecture, and then I guess that's not a problem. And now, so move over there. All right, so the basic idea is every quadratic form can be written. Every quadratic form can be written as Q of X is equal to X transpose AX, where A is symmetric. Okay, so that's like a sort of sister's assertion to one we made much, much earlier, which is that every linear transformation looks like T of X equals AX. That's something that we've said. Well, here we're saying every quadratic form looks like, sort of like an X squared, but with this A. And the relation is that the diagonal elements of A in position, say I comma I, is the coefficient of xi squared, whereas the off-diagonal element in position ij, with I not equal to j, is the coefficient of xi xj times a half. So it's one half the coefficient. And you might be wondering, why is it actually a half the coefficient? I don't know what my abbreviation for coefficient is. I use coef apostrophe t. So why is it one half? Well, in principle, you get an xi xj, but because it's symmetric, you also get an xi xj xi. And so those two coefficients together add up to give you the actual coefficient of xi xj. So if you prefer, when you see, say, 6 xi xj, say you see 6 x1 x2, you should think of that as 3 x1 x2 plus 3 x2 x1. And that sort of explains why you have a 3 in both the 1, 2 position and the 2, 1 position. Okay, so that's just a little bit of understanding there. No doubt you are very familiar with how to actually do this. this, but I should give you a simple example. I'll just give a two-dimensional example. Oh, I better do a 3D example. E.g., if Q of X, Y, Z, and I'll write it as three explicit variables, is X squared minus 5y squared plus 6z squared plus 2xy minus 3yz. So this doesn't conform to the x1, x2, x3. You have to mentally change it to xyz. But that's fine. Basically, we can say that Q of the vector x is equal to x transpose ax, where A is the following symmetric matrices. The symmetric matrix. It's going to be 3 by 3 because there are three variables. Coefficient of x is 1. Coefficient of 5 of y squared is minus 5. And the z squared is 6. So the diagonals just copy straight down. Xy corresponds to the 1, 2 position. We have to halve it. There's a factor of 2, so we're going to put the 2 distributed 1, 1 symmetrically around there. There is actually no xz, which would be a 1, 3. So we get a 0 and a 0. And then the yz corresponds to the 2, 3 position. And it has a coefficient of minus 3, so we have to halve that and put minus 3 halves there and minus 3 halves there. And if you do actually multiply this out for the vector x, y, z, you, as a matrix multiplication, you'll find you get exactly this. And if you haven't ever done it or seen it, it's really worth doing it, just to solidify your understanding. Okay, so that's all very elementary stuff about quadratic forms, but absolutely vital, because most of the time you get it in the top form, and you must convert it into a matrix to solve the problem. Any questions before I go on? Yes?
Is x horizontal?
Is x horizontal or vertical? Well, because it's symmetric, it doesn't really matter. This is one time where it doesn't matter. You're multiplying it on the left and the right, so it's got the whole symmetry built in. Any other questions? All right, so let's move on. Now, here is the real key. We're going to combine the fact that we can write a quadratic form in this type or in this way with the spectral theorem. And say the following. What you want is you write A, the A that you've got, in the form S, D, S, inverse, where S is orthogonal. That's the spectral theorem, which I just told you about. Again, it's vital that A be symmetric. Okay, so now here's the deal. If we replace x by this vector c, I don't know why the book uses c, but there you have it. C is s inverse x. Okay, so what this does is we're considering s as a change of basis matrix. And it's actually a really nice change of basis. An arbitrary change of basis turns, say, the regular nice basis where they all have length 1 and are orthogonal, so they're all normal, into some other basis where they could change lengths and they may be squished or expanded. But it's quite useful, you know, it can be useful for if you have an image that's sort of distorted or in perspective and you want to bring it back. That's the sort of change of basis. This one's much more benign, though. This is just like a rotation. The new basis, the columns of S inverse, or S, are orthonormal themselves. So all we're doing is rotating the system. So if the new graph of something turns out to be an ellipse, then the old one will be an ellipse but twisted. So it doesn't distort. It just rotates. It might also reflect as well. That's, reflections are also orthogonal. So this is the, I want you to look at this and think of this as a change of basis. So if C is the expression of X in the new change of basis, then I'm going to tell you the result and the proof in one. But just watch this. Q of X, a quadratic form, is X transpose AX. But X we're going to replace by SC. So, what am I trying to say here? actually, first, I won't do that yet. I'm going to replace A by S, D, S inverse. So we get X transpose S, D, S inverse X. And now a tiny bit of manipulation. I want to just work on this a little bit. I'm going to make a subclaim that if we take S inverse X and find its transpose, we get something interesting. First of all, S inverse is the same as S transpose. That's written up here. So this is S transpose X transpose. And by the transpose rules, this is equal to X transpose S transpose transpose, which is just S. Okay, so that little bit of manipulation says that, hey, this is equal to this whole quantity here. So I'm going to come over here, I'm going to replace this X transpose S by S inverse X transpose. D S inverse X. And I'll put parentheses around it. So what's the point of these shenanigans? Well, this is just the vector C transpose, and this is the vector C. So this actually has reduced to C transpose D C. Okay, so what? Well, let's look at this. X transpose A X. That's a full quadratic form with the diagonal elements coming from the diagonals of A, and you've got all these off-diagonal elements, which are the cross terms. And so it's a little harder to deal with than this, because D is a diagonal matrix. This is also in the quadratic form, C transpose D, C. But D is diagonal, so this is a diagonal quadratic form, meaning it's just the sum of squares, basically. There's no cross terms. Is a diagonal quadratic form. So the change of basis, which amounts to a rotation, reduces the quadratic form into something where, with no diagonals. Not non-diagonals, as in no cross terms. So it's sort of beautiful. That's exactly how you analyze these things. You have to do the change of basis because you get rid of the pesky cross terms. I'm not saying the cross terms are actually mad. It's not like the angry sort of cross. But I get cross when I have to deal with this. Okay, that was really terrible. I don't think I said it loud enough to be picked up on the video, but at least I was just cleaning the board. All right, so here is the basic idea. I.e., Q of X can be written as lambda 1 C1 squared plus lambda 2 C2 squared and so on plus lambda n Cn squared, where C, which is C1 up to Cn, can be computed as S inverse X and D is lambda 1 up to lambda n. Diagonal matrix. Okay, so this suggests the following technique, and I'm going to sort of be really explicit about it right now. So the technique is therefore, technique, given Q, write down A using the technique that I described. You copy the diagonal elements and halve the off diagonals and make it symmetric. Then diagonalize in the orthogonal sense. And I stated the spectral theorem, but I did not, but I also last time did an example of the orthogonal diagonalization. All we had to do was the regular diagonalization, but use Gram-Schmidt on all of the eigenspaces. So you can write down A equals S, D, S inverse. And once you have that, you can write this down, and that leads to exactly this. So if you have our eigenvalues, they come right here, bang, 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 and S inverse is just the same as S transpose. So it would actually be easier to write here S transpose X. So actually, you can evaluate the quadratic form very easily given any set of numbers. First of all, you multiply that vector on the left by the transpose of this S matrix here that you find. And that matrix, remember, has the columns as the eigenvectors, the orthonormal basis of eigenvectors. And the V you also got. And so you now know everything about the quadratic form. And it's much easier to evaluate. You can do it as a sum of squares. Now, if you want to graph it, the same technique helps. Before I show you a graph, and I'm going to do it all in two dimensions, because all the previous exam questions I've ever seen are in two dimensions, what I want to do is just say there are a few other definitions. So before we graph, a few definitions. And all you need to know is this. Each definition that we have has a sort of function version, and then it has an eigenvalue interpretation. So the first definition is that Q of X, or just Q, is positive definite. And that means that Q of X is always greater than zero. So that's true except when X equals zero. Of course, if X equals zero, then all the variables are zero, and because there's no constant terms, Q of zero is always zero for any quadratic form. So Q of zero equals zero. Just notice this.
One little thing about this. You don't need to learn this. This is for your... I hope it makes some sort of sense. That's the actual diagonalization mechanism that produces this. And that's what you have to actually learn. Someone asked me during that few minutes whether it was necessary to reproduce. No, it is not necessary to reproduce this. But it's good to understand it if you can anyway. All right, so now, I was just going to give you a few definitions of quadratic forms that are very important. And I was trying to say, first of all, the quadratic form at zero is always zero. This is the vector zero, meaning Q of 0, 0, 0, 0, 0 is the number zero. Okay? That's always true. But if Q of X is always positive for any other X, then we say Q is positive definite. Okay? Now, the eigenvalue interpretation, this happens when, well, we have to look at the top board. And this tells you that you can change x into c. The c's, the x's, the x1 up to xn can be changed into c and then plugged into that. So actually, if any of those lambdas are negative, then you can clearly make this negative by choosing the right x that gives you the right c. So that's no good. And even if one of the lambdas is zero, that's still no good. You could just put all of your eggs into that c and find which x gave you that c, and you would get a zero answer there. So the only way that this can be true in terms of the eigenvalues is that all eigenvalues must be positive. And these are the eigenvalues of the A matrix that's underlying the whole quadratic form. Quadratic form, immediately you can write down the A. If all the eigenvalues are positive, then you can say it's positive definite. And again, that means that Q of X will be positive except at zero. Okay, Q of X is positive semi-definite. And I'm abbreviating that to pos semi-def, but you should write out positive semi-definite. This means that Q of X is greater than or equal to zero for all X. Now there's no problem at x equals zero because we're only saying that's greater than or equal to zero. And that will occur if all the eigenvalues are greater than or equal to zero. So again, none of the eigenvalues can be negative there. Okay? Just to continue this little table, in gory detail, Q of x is negative definite, neg def, means that Q of x is less than 0 if x is not 0. And of course, all the eigenvalues have to be strictly negative there. And Q of x is negative semi-definite. Semi-definite if Q of x is less than or equal to 0 for all x. And that will happen if all lambda i's are less than or equal to 0. And finally, the most common case, if you like, is that none of the above. In which case, we say Q of x is indefinite. And the only way that can happen is if some of the eigenvalues are positive and some negative, strictly speaking. So some lambda I greater than 0 and some lambda j less than 0. You have to have at least one strictly positive and one strictly negative. If they're all positive and some are 0, then you're actually positive semi-definite. I guess the only case that's not considered is where they're all 0. But then that's a really boring quadratic form. Q of x equals 0 for all x. It probably doesn't even get a classification, although technically it's positive and negative semi-definite. It's just really boring. The 0 quadratic form. Necessary, but not interesting. To that formula. Okay, so in order to answer this, I just need to go back and sort of reiterate something that I said. Okay, Q here is any quadratic form. Okay, in the top, in this equation here, Q of x is any quadratic form, not necessarily a diagonal one. Okay, if it is a diagonal one, then it automatically can be written as lambda 1 x1 squared, not the c's, the lambdas, not the c's, x's. So you just have lambda 1 x1 squared and so on. Okay? Now, the beauty of the whole topic is that any quadratic form can, you can do a change of basis in the x, so replace the vector x you were given by some other vector c, and replace the quadratic form by some other quadratic form, which is diagonal, and is written out up there. Okay, so this is every quadratic form. Okay, every quadratic form can be written as a symmetric version, right? As in x. So quadratic forms and symmetric matrices are in exact correspondence with each other. In some sense, there's no difference between the two. For every one, you get some one of the other, and vice versa. Okay. Okay. Let me clarify this a little bit. Okay. This is just a different way, since there's been a couple of questions. I feel like I should say a few more things about the content of that board. Okay? So you start with a quadratic form, Q of x. So start with this. Okay? This generates an A, symmetric matrix A. Right? Which generates S and D. Okay? Beautiful. Now, so you understand how to get from the Q to the A and then to get the S and the D. Does anyone feel like they don't understand, at least in principle? I can barely hear you. then diagonalize orthogonally. That means write A equals S DS inverse, where S is orthogonal and D is diagonal. And again, if you don't know what that means, you need to watch the video at the end of Thursday, because I don't have time to go over it again. But we will probably end up doing some examples in the Q&A. So I just want you to understand, the Q gives you the symmetric matrix A, which gives you an orthogonal matrix S and a diagonal matrix D. Now, I have a new quadratic form. I'm going to express this in a different way. So let's let R of X, actually I'll write R of C. This is a different quadratic form. And I'm going to write, so let this be a different quadratic form in, say, the C variables. And it's going to be lambda 1 C squared plus lambda 2 C2 squared plus lambda n Cn squared. Now, where do these lambdas come from? They're not just any old lambdas. They are the lambdas that come from D. The lambda comes from D. i.e. they are the eigenvalues of A. So starting with my original Q, I came up with an A, I found its eigenvalues, and I stuck them in this diagonal matrix, and then I could immediately write down this other quadratic form. Well, so what? Here's the deal. If C is equal to S transpose X, where S is this S that we found here, which consists of eigenvectors of A in the right order, as in the same order as lambda I, and they have to be orthogonal or orthonormal, in fact. If this is true, then Q of X equals R of C. So the two quadratic forms are not specifically the same, but they're very much related, so that if you want to find Q of X, actually, you could find C by doing this multiplication here and then plugging the numbers that you got into R of C. So what it actually does is it comes up with a new quadratic form and tells you that you could use that to compute the old one if you just change the inputs. See, what you're normally doing for Q, if you want to compute Q of X, is you're plugging in whatever the numbers are, 3, 2, 7, okay? Plug them in, you get an answer. I'm giving you an alternative. If you've done a little bit of work on the matrix A, I'm saying instead of 3, 2, 7, take that vector 3, 2, 7, and instead of plugging it into Q, multiply it by S transpose. You get a different vector, which you can then plug into this. You get the same answer as if you had done the original plug-in. And you might say, oh, well, surely it was simpler to plug in. Okay, but if you want to graph it, this is much easier. And now let's actually apply this for two-dimensional graphs.
You have to do that every time, C1, C2.
Yeah, you have to do this every time.
And with the corresponding X1.
Yeah, but normally we're not interested in computing. We're normally interested in graphing these things, level sets of them. So you'll see, I'm going to apply this whole theory. I admit this presentation is slightly different from the book, but I think it's more intuitive. And it certainly helps with these graphing sort of questions. So the typical application, so this is 2D version, two-dimensional graphing. So here's the task. We have a quadratic form in two variables. And by the way, almost every past final has a question just like this. In fact, they often write it as Q of X, Y. So we have some quadratic form of two variables. And it just looks like ax squared plus bxy plus cy squared. And you're asked to graph a level set. Graph a level set, which means q of xy is some number k. Often it's just 1. Q of xy equals 1. Especially Q of xy equals 1. But sometimes they throw in another number here. Actually, you could just divide, if this is some other number k, you could just divide k into all of these things and get the equivalent thing, except when k equals 0. That's a special case, which is not very interesting either. Okay, So here it is. How do you graph these things? If it were not for the bxy term, it would be quite straightforward. Ax squared plus cy squared is really nice. Okay, so here's the idea. We're going to do this. We're going to take q, I'm going to consider it now of x1, x2 instead, which is qx, which is x transpose ax. So we're going to find the a. So we're going to write down a, and we're going to diagonalize it as A equals S D S inverse, where S is orthogonal. Then we're going to assert that Q of X1, X2 is equal to lambda 1 C1 squared plus lambda 2 C2 squared. And there's only two variables, where C1, C2 are the coordinates of X with respect to the columns of S. Which are the eigenvalues, or eigenvectors of A. And that's the entire theory. But in order to make it come to life, we have to draw some pictures. Okay, here goes. Suppose we want to graph, so for example, suppose we find that both lambda 1 and lambda 2 are positive. So we find there's two positive eigenvalues of this matrix A. Then we will have to graph C1 lambda 1 squared, I'm sorry, lambda 1 C1 squared plus lambda 2 C2 squared equals K. You need to graph that on two sets of axes. First, the C1 C2 axes. Well, what does that look like? Lambda 1 and lambda 2 are positive numbers. What does that look like? It looks like an ellipse. This is an ellipse. And the only thing you have to be careful of is where these numbers are. So to find the C1 intercept, you set C2 equals 0. So you will get, if C2 equals 0, this is a little aside here, you get lambda 1 C1 squared equals K, which means that C1 is plus or minus the square root of K over lambda 1. So this is the square root of K over lambda 1. And this is minus the square root of K over lambda 1. And similarly, this will be root K over the square over lambda 2 square root. And this will be minus root k over lambda 2. Now, I don't recommend that you learn that formula. Instead, you should know how to find intercepts of an ellipse. You should recognize it as an ellipse and look at the equation. Okay, lambda 1 and lambda 2, you know, because you've diagonalized this and you found they're both positive. K is normally 1, but even if it's not, you know what it is. If it's negative, you're kind of screwed because this doesn't, it's not anything. if this is minus 1, there's no sum of two squares with positive coefficients that's negative, so there's no graph. Okay, so the interesting case is not when k is negative. Okay, so what I want you to understand is this works always. Whenever the two eigenvalues are positive, you're going to get an ellipse and you can draw it on those axes. The only thing left to do is to draw the actual ellipse, which is just a rotated version of this. So the actual ellipse in the xy plane, you need to find the columns of V, of S. Suppose S looks like V1, V2. Those are the eigenvectors of S, and they should be orthonormal if you've done this correctly. This is supposed to be a 2x2 orthogonal matrix. So all you have to do is draw the V1 vector and the V2 vector and rotate this picture here. It's all supposed to go through 0. And this length here is supposed to be the same length as this. So that length is lambda 1. That's the length. And that's called the semi-major axis. This is the major axis. The length, the semi-major length, or the length of the semi-major axis is half as much. It's easier to deal with than 2 times this quantity. And the semi-minor would be this. Now, actually, the way I've drawn it, lambda 1 has to be less than lambda 2. That's the way I've drawn it, because the reciprocal is bigger. So in this case, we actually have lambda 1 less than lambda 2. Otherwise, the ellipse would be more bulgy that way. But anyway, this length here is the other length, root k over lambda 2. Okay, so what I've done is given you a complete prescription of how to actually draw this ellipse. Question. Yes, if any orthogonal matrix has the length, the columns are an orthonormal basis. So in this case, you find two eigenvectors, right? If they don't have length 1 when you write them down, you have to normalize them first before you write them into S.
If you're trying to graph it, why do you have to find the length?
Well, if you're trying to graph it, you actually don't have to find the length. You just need the direction. I'll give you that. But in terms of the vectors themselves, I think if they have length 1, they seem more to me to be like coordinate axes. And then I can talk about a certain multiple of this column, and then I know how far away I am from the origin. So in particular, sometimes they will ask you the question, what is the closest that you can be to the origin on the ellipse? What is the furthest that you can be? Well, this is the closest. It's the minimum of these two numbers. Whatever this number is and this number is. The smaller one is the closest, and the larger one is the furthest. And you can tell that even from the unrotated version. If they then ask, what is a vector in xy space which is the closest? Well, then you need to say it's this much of v1 is the furthest, and this much, that quantity of v2 is the closest. And that is where I think it would be particularly good to know exactly what the normalized versions are, so that you can then say, well, this much of it is this, and you can write down that answer. And there was a question in one of the previous finals that did this. I don't know where it is, but I'm sure someone will ask it. Yes, the major axis by definition, or the semi-major axis, is longer than the semi-minor axis. Whichever one is longer is the major. And if they're the same, it's a circle. You don't call it an ellipse, you call it a circle. And you call it a radius. Okay? Another question. The question is, does 0, 1 lie on the ellipse? You mean this point here? No. I haven't told you. The ellipse, this ellipse could be any ellipse whatsoever. It could be any size or... Okay, so here's the deal. V1 is along this direction, in my graph anyway. V2 is along this direction. But if you want to know what the actual vector v1 is, it's a length 1 that way, and v2 is a length 1 this way. And then how far you are along depends on these numbers here, which depend on the eigenvalues. So the direction depends on the eigenvectors, but not the eigenvalues. The shape of the ellipse depends on the eigenvalues, but not the eigenvectors. And together, you have everything that you need. Okay? That might be worth writing down. The shape of the ellipse is the eigenvalues. And, of course, the number k, but that just k just blows up the ellipse or shrinks it, depending on how big it is. So if you just make k bigger, you just actually are expanding the ellipse. But the shape is in whether it's stretched out or squished up or, you know, closer to a circle, depends on lambda 1 and lambda 2. The orientation, as in the rotation amount, depends on the eigenvectors only, not the eigenvalues. Okay? So, the other case is a hyperbola, and I need to show you how that works. It's the same sort of principle. So the idea of the hyperbola is going to be if one of the lambdas is positive and the other one is negative. So if lambda 1 is positive and lambda 2 is negative, then you have q of x, by the same token, you can write as lambda 1 c1 squared plus lambda 2 c2 squared as before, but this is negative. So when you actually write it down, it will look like lambda 1 c1 squared minus something. And I'm writing it specifically like this because this will be a positive number. After all, if lambda 2 is negative, then minus lambda 2 is positive. But that's the sort of nicer way to see it. Okay, so what does the graph of this look like? Well, again, I'm going to distinguish between the c-axis and the x-axis. In the c-axis, you get a hyperbola. Now, that point is the same c-intercept as before. It's the square root of k over lambda 1. That's this point here. And this is minus root k over lambda 1. There. But this time you'll get a hyperbola. But the question is, how squishy is it? What are these asymptotic lines? Hyperbolas have asymptotes. Well, if you want to be really precise, then you can write down the slope, but I've never seen this particularly examined. Slope given by lambda 2. Slope involves lambda 2. And if anyone can show me a question where you actually had to compute the slope, then I'd be very happy to do it. But it's really not very difficult. You just have to work out what is the limiting ratio of C1 to C2. And you'll find that I believe it is, now you're going to stretch me here, I think it's root lambda 2 over lambda 1. I think it's root lambda 2 over lambda 1. But I'll check it if you want later. Maybe I'll do the specific example, and then we'll really understand what's going on. Okay, so then the only difference is we need to do the same rotation. So if you have V1 here and V2 here, again, you're going to get and this distance is the same as that distance there, root k over lambda 1, the positive. And so is that distance. Okay? Question. Well, because I'm assuming lambda 2 is negative. So minus lambda 2 is positive. So when you actually write it down, it'll look like something C1 squared minus something C2 squared. In fact, look, before you ask any other questions about hyperbolas, I have an example that works about hyperbola that I like to do. Specific example from a previous finding.
Are those critical functions that you
The question is that point the actual, this point here is exactly that quantity times V1. But that only works if V1 is normalized, which is what you were asking about before. That's why I want you to normalize the V1, so you can actually find the point if need be. And I'll do that in this example too. Okay, bear with me. We'll do this example and then we'll take a break. Here's the example from a previous final. It says, graph, okay, please, we will take a break after this. X squared minus 8xy minus 5y squared equals 12. And the question is also, find the closest points to the origin. Find the closest points to the origin. As well. So graph. Okay, so I intend to practice what I preach by following the entire procedure. Here goes. First of all, let Q of x be this quadratic form without the 12. It's just x squared minus x, 8xy minus 5y squared. And I intend to write this as xy transpose axy, where I'm being very good and I'm writing out xy instead of just the vector x, where a equals 8, I'm sorry, 1 is the coefficient of x squared, minus 5 is the coefficient of y squared, and this minus 8 gets distributed as minus 4, minus 4, half each, symmetric matrix. Okay, let's find the eigenvalues of a. Okay, what's the question? Haven't I already taken the transpose? Oh, yeah, you're right. Thank you. I already took the transpose. Okay, the eigenvalues of A are as follows. Compute det of 1 minus lambda minus 4 minus 4 minus 5 minus lambda. I compute this determinant to be 1 minus lambda minus 5 minus lambda subtract minus 4 times minus 4. There are other ways of finding these eigenvalues in a 2 by 2, but I'm going to play pat and use the actual formula. I get lambda squared plus 5 lambda minus lambda, which is plus 4 lambda. I'll have a minus 5 there, and then I'll have a minus 16, which works out to lambda squared plus 4 lambda minus 21, which actually factors into lambda plus 7, lambda minus 3. So the eigenvalues are lambda equals 3 and minus 7. So which order do I choose to do them in? I'll do minus 7 first. What the hey? It doesn't matter which order you get them in. It's fine. Okay, next I have to find the eigenvectors and normalize them. Okay, so for lambda equals minus 7, I'm looking for the kernel of, well, a plus 7i, which is the kernel of this matrix with lambda replaced by minus 7. So you'll get 8 minus 4 minus 4 and 2. And of course, this you can divide by 4. And this you could divide by minus 2, and you'll just get 2, 1 in both places. So you'll find that if you get 2, 1 and 2, 1, you could just subtract the first row from the second. The second row is just, this is just a duplicate of this. Sorry? Yes, thank you. Which is equal to the span of, just straightforwardly, if I put a 1 there and a 2 there, it's clearly going to work. Right, 2 times 1 minus 1 times 2. It's not orthogonal yet, but we'll work on that. For lambda equals 3, we need to take the kernel of A minus 3i, which is the kernel of plus plug in lambda equals 3 there, and you'll get minus 2, minus 4, and you'll get... kernel of 1200. And that will be the span. And if the first vector is 2 and the other one is minus 1, that will work. Is that the way I did it? Yeah. It doesn't really matter again. 2 minus 1. Okay. So actually, we found our S and our D, believe it or not. We just have to normalize these vectors. So V1, I'll take that first vector, 1, 2. Its length is root 5, because 1 plus 2 squared, 1 squared plus 2 squared is 5. So it's going to be 1 over root 5, 2 over root 5. And V2 also has root 5 as its length. And we have 2 over root 5 minus 1 over root 5. Okay, here's a reality check. You have two vectors. What should their dot product be? 0. Is it? Yes. Just multiply, do the dot product. If not, if it's 0, you screwed up. Okay, so what's the point of all these shenanigans? It looks like we've done nothing. But that whole chain of argument tells us exactly this. It tells us immediately that if you want, in the matrix version, we have A is S D S inverse, where S is equal to this matrix whose columns are these V1, V2. So it's 1 over root 5, 2 over root 5, 2 over root 5, minus 1 over root 5, which will be orthogonal. And D is minus 7, 3. And it's... the only thing is, you have to write these in the same order as these vectors. You can't switch that around or else you'll get the wrong answer. Okay, but in terms, that's just nice. That's just the orthogonal diagonalization. But in terms of the quadratic form, I can say that my q of x, this is the original function we started with, which is q of x y, is equal to minus 7, say, instead of C1 squared, well, I'll use C1 squared, what the hell. Minus 7 C1 squared plus 3 C2 squared. Where did I get the minus 7 and the 3? These are the eigenvalues. And what are C1, C2? Where C1, C2 is equal to S transpose XY. So actually, given XY, all you have to do is take the transpose of this and multiply that out, and there's C1 and there's C2. You know exactly what it is. But all we have to do, though, is graph it. And on the C1, C2 axes, it'll look like this. We have to be a little careful because we have the minus sign here. So I've been a little creative and flipped the damn thing around. So the x-intercept is actually not existent. It's the y-intercept, or the C2 intercept, will be where? Well, we're supposed to graph this equals 12. Don't forget the 12. That came out of the original question. Way up there. Top of that board is the 12. So the C2 intercept will have 3 C2 squared equals 12, which means C2 is plus or minus 2. So actually, we put in a 2 here. We put in a minus 2. And if you wanted extra brownie points, you could work out the slope of these intercepts here. Maybe we'll do that later. But for the moment, that's the graph in the C1, C2 space. It's a hyperbola pointing up and down. And now, for the full points, to finish off the problem, we need at least the graph at first. So we need to find where is V1 and V2. Well, V1 is along the direction 1, 2. So for this, I will ignore the root 5, and I'll look at, this is V1 here, at least the direction. So I'm going to draw the direction 1, 2, which looks like this. 1, 2. And it's this axis here. This is the V1 direction. And the V2 direction must be orthogonal to it. It's actually written as 2 comma minus 1, which is down here. 2 comma minus 1. But the picture will be symmetric anyway. And now all I need to do is go a distance of 2 along here. So I'm going to go 2 and 2. And I'm going to attempt to replicate that picture. I've run out of space. I don't know where these lines are. Okay, what's the question? Okay, yes, so we're going to do the second part of the problem that will make this completely clear. So actually, you notice that the 2 is along the C2 line. So that means this point is 2 along the V2 line. So just geometrically, we're asked, what is the closest point on this curve to the origin, or what are the closest points? And you can see that they occur here and here. And now we just need to describe the closest points. Well, it's quite straightforward. Closest points are plus or minus 2V2. It's V2 because that was the one with the positive eigenvalue, and it's 2 because that's the distance here. Did I call it U2? I don't know. I called it V2, but maybe I should call this V1 and V2, and then this is U1, U2. I don't know. It would be better to, I agree, it would be better to call that V1, V2. Maybe we can just point the camera over here. I'm just to be consistent with previous notation. We will call this V1. We will call this V2. And then we will rename these U1. And the only difference is we divided by the length. This makes it more consistent with what I had before. And in which case, all right. In which case, this is U1 and this is U2. Okay, so the closest points are plus or minus 2 U2, which is plus or minus 2 times the vector 2 root 5 minus 1 root 5. And so explicitly, they are the points 4 over root 5, comma minus 2 root 5, and it's negative. Okay? So everything came out of the diagonalization. Without that, it's really hard to come up with this picture. There's 2 types of dynamical systems. You saw them separately when we did them, but it makes more sense to study them together, even though one's in chapter 6 and the other's sort of in chapter 9. So anyway, we have discrete, and it looks like this. You're given x of t plus 1, where t is time, is ax of t. And you have some initial value x0, which is x of 0. So x at time 0, this process, is the vector x sub 0. Okay, well, the solution of this turns out to be, as you can see by induction, x of t is the tth power of a times the original vector. So when t equals 0, this is the 0th power, which is just the identity, times x0. And then for future values of t, you have to take the tth power of a. So that's a times a times a times a, t times. Okay? So clearly this is very painful to work out most of the time, but if possible, and it should always be possible, I hope, in this course, diagonalize A. So A equals SD S inverse. And I just want to emphasize that here we are not assuming A is symmetric. A, not necessarily symmetric anymore. So in particular, S won't be orthogonal most of the time. S doesn't need to be orthogonal. Okay, that's just a comment for sanity's sake, since we've spent the entire time talking about symmetric matrices. Banish them for this topic. You don't need them. Okay, so if that's true, then x of t has a very straightforward expression as the following. You get s diagonal to the power of t, s inverse x0. See, this is a to the t. To take the tth power of this diagonalized form, you just need the tth power of the diagonal part. So I want to emphasize d to the power of t, it's really straightforward. You just take the tth power of all the eigenvalues and pack them into the diagonal matrix. Of course, you still have to multiply by S inverse and S. When you compute this, by the way, you may want to write this down. You should compute this vector first. Don't multiply these matrices together and then multiply it. Instead, compute this vector, because it's easier to multiply the matrix by the vector. Then compute this vector, then compute this vector. But you do have to find S inverse if you want to do it explicitly. Okay, so that's the general plan of attack. Again, you have to diagonalize, which means finding eigenvalues and then finding eigenvectors. If you can't diagonalize, the thing is much more horrible, except in the complex case of which we will look at in a bit. And actually, we don't even do the complex case for discrete, although we could. It's just not in the book, so I won't do it. Now, let's look at the continuous case and see how similar it is. Continuous case, the equation becomes a differential equation. Dx of t dt is equal to ax of t. And again, this is to be interpreted as a simultaneous lot of linear differential equations. And we've seen how to do that. Maybe I'll do an example in the complex case to make it a little simpler. Okay, so the idea here is that now, the solution looks like this. So first of all, diagonalize A if possible. If possible. And if the length of the Zambria rule. So let's just say real diagonalize A, and we'll worry about the complex case later. So it's sort of understood when I say diagonalize, real diagonalize A if possible. So A is S D S inverse again. This time the equation, the solution, and I should have said x of 0 equals x0 again, this x naught vector. So the solution works out to be x of t is equal to s, and then this matrix, e to the lambda 1 t, e to the lambda 2 t, e to the lambda n t, s inverse x0. Okay, so compare the discrete and the continuous. The same. The only difference between the two scenarios is that in the discrete, you have the tth power of lambda 1 in the diagonal matrix, and then lambda 2, etc. Whereas in the continuous case, you have e to the lambda 1, t. And they're not as different as they even look. I mean, they look very similar. But actually, if you consider e to the lambda 1 t as e to the lambda 1 to the power of t, then it's also a tth power. See, this is a tth power of lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n. This is a tth power of e to the lambda 1, e to the lambda 2, and so on. E to the lambda n. So actually, it's the same theory for both. It's exactly the same theory. It's just you're working with different eigenvalues. Here, you're working with the pure eigenvalues. Whereas here, you're working with the exponentials of the eigenvalues of the matrix. That's the only difference. But this does create a for us. If all these lambdas, say, are positive, then all these exponential of lambdas are bigger than 1. And if any of these are negative, e to the lambda is less than 1 but still positive. So in particular, these numbers have to be positive. And it changes the system a little bit. It means that what was negative over here becomes less than 1 over here, and what was positive here becomes bigger than 1 over here. And that may have been confusing when you look at some of these diagrams in the book, but that's all it comes down to. Okay, great. So you can solve any of these right now, any of this case. I'll do the complex case soon. But you can solve this, either the discrete or the continuous, using exactly what's on this board right here. That's the entire theory of it in a nutshell. Okay, and it all rests on the diagonalization. If you can't diagonalize, then you can't do quadratic forms and you can't do dynamical systems. So diagonalize. Make sure you can. Okay. In two dimensions, you have these phase portraits. Of course, you can have them in any number of dimensions. But for 2D, phase portraits. You need to identify the eigenvectors. The eigenvectors, which are columns of S. And again, S is not necessarily an orthogonal matrix. It will only be if the A matrix in either of these cases is symmetric. And I said it's not normally symmetric. So these are not necessarily orthogonal. Orthonormal, even. Orthogonal. That's a little comment, just again, don't want to get confused. And what I'm going to do is just a hypothetical case. Of course, you have to identify them and draw their directions. So let's hypothetically say that this is the eigenvector for lambda 1, and this is the eigenvector for lambda 2. And I'm going to draw a few cases. Okay. First case, suppose we are in the discrete case where both eigenvalues are bigger than 1 and lambda 1 is bigger than lambda 2. Well, what does this look like? Come over here. This S inverse and S just change the basis. So that instead of the standard bases, x and y, you are now thinking of this as the new x-axis, if you like, or the lambda 1 axis, and this is the lambda 2 axis. So the diagram already reflects the change of basis. You just have to understand, with respect to this coordinate here, I want to graph whatever this axis is. Maybe I'll call this c1, and this is c2. So what I'm graphing is c1 is lambda 1 to the power of t times whatever the initial value is. So I'm graphing this. I need a little scratch space here. I'm graphing c1 is lambda 1 to the t times whatever the initial value is. I'll just call it a. And I'm just going to call this axis the c1 axis. I'm just going to call this the c2 axis. Just to be consistent with my previous pictures. I need some labels for them. And according to this formula, this says that the coordinate of x with respect to this new basis is lambda 1 to the power of t times whatever the initial value is. So I'm sort of letting this be the vector AB, just for conceptual purposes. Okay? And I don't know where I start, and the phase portrait says you just start somewhere and see what you get. So all I'm saying is that I have to draw this curve here. This is a parametric curve for some choice of A and B, lambda 1 to the T, A, lambda 2 to the T, B, and it ends up looking like this. Okay, what does this mean? This is a bit of a fudge, actually. But let me explain what it means. Suppose your starting point is actually here. That's your x0, say. Where will x1 be? 1 second later, you will be somewhere further along this curve. And then so on. So you actually, in discrete time, advance your way up that curve. What if you started here? Well, then you work your way up here. If you started on this, you just work your way along the eigenvector. If you started on here, again, and again, and again. And you're always going bigger because lambda 1 is bigger than 1. So lambda 1 to the power of t gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And lambda 2 to the power of t also gets bigger and bigger. So that is what the phase portrait has to look like. We use a continuous version. The true curve, if you really wanted to say what is the actual phase portrait, you should be graphing every possible level set of this and fleshing the whole thing out. And then no matter where you started, your bases would be covered. But you know, typically you just draw one of each type of curve. Now, it turns out, oh, you have a question about this first? Is it going to be a parabola? No, it's not, strictly speaking, a quadratic. Here's what it is. Suppose I gave you the following. Suppose I said for some constants A and B, which I'm not going to tell you what they are, x is lambda 1 to the t A, and y, actually, yeah, y is lambda, let's call it y and x for the moment. X is lambda 2 to the t B. So what's the actual equation of y in terms of x? Well, I think you'll find that y is equal to lambda 1 over lambda 2 to the t, lambda 2 to the t, a. Do you agree with that? If y is lambda 1 to the power t, a, then y is lambda 1 over lambda 2 to the t times lambda 2 to the t, a. The lambda 2's just cancel out. Okay, so what? Well, this is actually here x over b. So you get this number, lambda 1 over lambda 2 to the power of t. You get a constant, which is a over b, and then you get x. Okay? Is this what I wanted to say? This is just so not what I wanted to say that something has gone horribly wrong. I need more room. I've made a mistake. Here it is. Y is lambda 1 to the t times a. X is lambda 2 to the t times b. So y is lambda 1 over lambda 2 to the power of t, lambda 2 to the power of t, a. Let's just see what the hell's going on here. I hate thinking at the board. Yep, it'll approach a linear, but it's not actually a linear. What am I doing? I'm very tired. Must try to think. That's not what I want to do at all. Yeah, that's not what I want to do at all. Here's what I want to do. I want to say that y is a constant times x to a power. That's what I want to do. And it's really hard in the discrete case. So I'm going to do the continuous case for surface. Then everything will be cheese. Okay. So hold that thought. It's possible, but it's just going to involve logarithms, and I want to avoid that. Okay. So bear with me for a second. See this? I claim this is also the picture in the following case. Continuous with lambda 1 bigger than lambda 2 bigger than 0. Okay, if that's the case, as I told you, everything in the continuous case is the same as the discrete case, but with e to the lambda 1, e to the lambda 2 in the discrete sense. So if lambda 1 and lambda 2 are bigger than 0, then e to the lambda 1 and e to the lambda 2 are bigger than 1. And then just using the fact that they're the same sort of formula, you get the same picture. Okay, so in that case, in the continuous case, I have y is e to the lambda 1 t a, and x is e to the lambda 2 t b. Okay, now I can do my trick without any real difficulty here. Y is e to the lambda 1 t a, which is what? It's e to the lambda 2 t to the power lambda 1 over lambda 2 times a. Okay, so what? Well, this is x over b, because e to the lambda 2 t is x over b, to this power lambda 1 over lambda 2 times a. And that is equal to some messy constant, x to the lambda 1 over lambda 2. The messy constant is a over b to this power. So what I'm trying to say is the actual graph that you get here looks like, with respect to these axes, which are already skew, y equals cx to a power bigger than 1. This is just a number bigger than 1 because lambda 1 is bigger than lambda 2. Okay? So the question was, is this a quadratic? Is this a parabola? No, for two reasons. One is that the power is not necessarily 2. It's some number bigger than 1 that's actually the ratio of the lambda 1 to lambda 2. Okay? And second, it's distorted. So even if lambda 1 was exactly twice lambda 2 in the continuous case, in which case it would be a perfect parabola, an actual quadratic parabola, if only these eigenvectors were perpendicular. Parabola and drew it, and then you went, it would be a distorted parabola anyway. Okay, so the only time you'll actually get a parabola for sure will be if, in the continuous case, one of them is twice the other, and they're both positive, and the matrix is symmetric so that the eigenvectors are orthogonal. But anyway, in basically, the idea being that either in the discrete case, for lambda 1, greater than lambda 2, greater than 1, along the lambda 1 thing, you'll have that sort of behavior. And also in the continuous case, you have this. And all the arrows go outward. So before I do the other, I'm going to do the other two cases, but you have a question.
If you had the same lambda, lambdas?
Yeah, if you had the same lambdas, lambda 1 equals...
Discrete and continuous
case. Okay, so the question is, if you have the same lambdas, so you have lambda 1 equals lambda 2. No.
The lambda 1 for the discrete case is the same as the lambda 1 for the continuous.
Well, I mean, what I'm trying to say is, if you have a continuous case with lambda 1 and lambda 2, that would be equivalent to the discrete case, but with e to the lambda 1 and e to the lambda 2. You get the same answer. You can turn any continuous problem into a discrete problem by exponentiating, and you could turn any discrete into a continuous by sort of taking the log if they happen to be positive.
The phase would be the same shape.
Yeah, it would not be the same because the ratio lambda 1 to lambda 2 that popped up as the power here only works in the discrete case, in the continuous case. If you were in the discrete case, it would actually be log lambda 1 over log lambda 2. And that's too advanced for this. You don't have to worry about that. But you should know the shape, and you should be aware that the wide part of the bowl opens around the eigenvalue that's bigger. Okay, so just remember that, even if you don't sort of want to write down those equations and manipulate them like I did on the rightmost board. I'm sorry, the question is what? Where's the semicircle? The bowl is such, yeah, so that when you're near zero, the lambda 2 coordinate is bigger. And when you're near infinity, the lambda 1 coordinate is bigger. And that's because you just look at lambda 1 to the t versus lambda 2 to the t. Lambda 1 is bigger, so when t is larger, the tth power of lambda 1 is much bigger. So think of this as like a 3 to the t versus 2 to the t. When t is huge, 3 to the t is bigger than 2 to the t. That means this coordinate is much bigger. You're much higher up this way than you are here. Whereas when t is small, you're looking at like 1 over 3 to the t, which is much less than 1 over 2 to the t. And so when t is near 0, actually this coordinate is much bigger. Okay, so everything is consistent with that. All right, I've got to show you the other two pictures, and then we'll do the complex case. Okay, so the second case is the following. Again, here's the bigger of the two. Here's the smaller of the two. In the discrete case, if lambda 1 is bigger than 1, it's bigger than lambda 2. And I'm going to assume they're both positive. By the way, if one of the eigenvalues is negative in the discrete case, you get this weird flipping behavior where you go flip, 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 flip. It's like an alternating series. And so we kind of avoid it because it's too messy. So in the discrete case, if that's the case, you get these hyperboloid-like things, but they're, again, not the correct power. They're not 1 over x. They're 1 over x to some power, and they're distorted. And what's more, the lambda 1 coordinate is the one that's big. So all roads along the lambda 1 point outwards, whereas all roads along the lambda 2 point inwards. Okay, again, you're looking at lambda 1 to the power of t versus lambda 2 to the power of t. And actually, this is smaller than 1, so this goes to 0, and this goes to infinity. So what I'm saying is when t gets large, the lambda 1 coordinate is getting bigger and bigger, or bigger and bigger negatively, whereas the lambda 2 coordinate is going to 0. So you're getting squished towards this axis. So that's how you get this diagram. In the continuous case, if you think about the case where what would give you e to the lambda 1 is bigger than 1, you'll find that lambda 1 has to be bigger than 0, whereas lambda 2 has to be less than 0. And that gives you the same picture. Again, if you think about it as discrete version, is that e to the lambda 1 is bigger than 1, it's bigger than e to the lambda 2, which of course is positive. And so that corresponds to this. But instead of lambda 1 and lambda 2, you see the exponentials. Okay, and the final possibility for the discrete case is that both eigenvalues are less than 1. And the continuous analog would be that they're both negative, because then their exponentials are less than 1, but still positive. And in that case, you get a sort of strange inversion of this. First of all, the lambda 2 coordinate being actually more negative, if you like, is more dominant in a sense as t goes to minus infinity. So actually what you'll get is this, which looks like the same as the first case but flipped. But all the arrows point inwards. And again, if you think about it in the discrete case, you have lambda 1 to the t, and you have lambda 2 to the t. And these are numbers less than 1, so as you take powers and powers, they go to 0. Both of them go to 0 as t goes to infinity. And so what this means is all the arrows have to point to the origin. But what's more, when T is very large, again, the lambda 1 is bigger than lambda 2, so this is going to be a bigger number than this. So that means that you're going to be higher along here than you are along there. So it has to look like this. And this is the only case where x of t goes to 0 as x goes to infinity, as t goes to infinity. That's the only case where that's true. No matter where you start, you get driven to the origin. That these lines show you your flow path as time goes on. Okay, so actually here you will have x of t goes to 0 as t goes to infinity, but only along the V space, only along V2, which is the eigenvector for the negative eigenvalue, or the eigenvalue less than 1, depending on which case you're in. And the arrows make that clear. No matter where else you start, you will not get driven to 0. But if you start along that magic line, you will go straight along the line to 0. Here, you never go to 0 unless you start at 0, in which case you get stuck there. Question? Well, when I do this in the continuous case or the discrete case, what I would do is the eigenvectors in either case tell me the directions of these lines, right? I mean, they could be anywhere. Okay, so they tell me the directions. The eigenvalues, one sensible approach would be to learn these things. I mean, it's learning with understanding is always better, but in a pinch, if you can learn that 1 is the magic number for discrete and 0 for continuous, then you don't have to worry about the exponentials. If you can just memorize this, this, and then the other three conditions, then you'll be fine. My idea was that if you just learnt the discrete, you could convert a continuous into discrete by exponentiating. But another way of looking at it is, if you're discrete, the magic number is 1. If you're continuous, it's 0. So this case is where they're both bigger than the magic number, whatever it is. This case, one of them's bigger and one of them's smaller. This case, they're both smaller. It's just that, again, the magic number is 1 for discrete and 0 for continuous. That's a good way to learn it. And the reason is that e to the 0 is 1. Okay. Any questions before I do the complex case, and then we do Q&A if there's any time left? No questions? Okay, here's the complex case. There's a special case which we'll only do in continuous, when you cannot diagonalize in a real sense. Okay, special case. Two-dimensional continuous where the eigenvalues of A are, say, P plus or minus IQ. So that's not real diagonalizable. We cannot write A in the form SD S inverse. We saw that we could write A equals SR S inverse, where R is a rotation scaling matrix. We spent quite a lot of time on that in the previous session towards the beginning. So basically, if you're in two-dimensional continuous where you happen to find those eigenvalues there, then there is a very special condition. There's a very special way of finding it. And I'm going to just give you the answer and not do any theory about it, and then we'll do an example. The only theory I need to tell you about is the phase diagrams, and so we'll do that. We'll knock that out. Okay, here's the way we do it. What you do is, having found those two eigenvalues, you write the following. So you take lambda equals p plus iq and find the eigenvector, which I'm going to write v plus iw. Okay? You do not need to find the other eigenvector, because the other eigenvalue you automatically know is P minus IQ, and the other eigenvector is V minus IW. So don't waste your time finding that. You form the matrix S, which, careful, is WV. Don't ask me why. It just is. But that's the same as it was when we did the diagonalization before. And the solution is then the following. X of t, and you just have to, I think you should just learn this. Just learn this solution. X of t is e to the power of pt, which is just a scalar, times this S matrix that I've just written up, times the following rotation matrix. Cosine qt minus sine qt, sine qt, cosine qt. And then, as before, you have S inverse x0. That's the complete prescription of how to find it. So you need to find the eigenvalues, and you put the real part in this exponential here, and the complex part, the imaginary part, goes into the sines and cosines, which sort of makes sense because e to the iq is cosine q plus I sine q. Makes some sort of sense. And then finally, you need to find the eigenvector and take its imaginary part, shove it there, and its real part there. I would have preferred to put the V and the W in the right order, but then you kind of need the minus down here. And rotation matrices, you normally put the minus up here because you like to go clockwise, counterclockwise. So I don't know. It's just a sort of fact. Okay. So before we do an example, let's just look at the phase diagrams, and I'll cram them on one board. Everything depends here. Depends only on the sine of p. See, if p equals 0, then e to the pt is 1. And so that doesn't come into it. This is a rotation, and so all you get is some sort of change of basis of a circle. If s was the identity, then you'd just be going around a circle. Wherever x0 is, you start there, and you'd be going around a circle. So, however, S distorts the circle into an ellipse. So you get an ellipse. And again, you need to sort of know what V and W are. So here's like a V, here's a W, and you get some sort of ellipse like that. And whether or not you go counterclockwise or clockwise, it depends on the sine of Q, actually. If Q is positive, you should go clockwise, counterclockwise. And if Q is negative, well, actually, it depends on whether you've written V and W in this order. Maybe I should write them like this. There we go. I don't know. We don't really care about the direction. We should, but we don't. If P is greater than 0, then you do get this ellipse. But you also have this e to the pt, which is getting bigger and bigger. So you're sort of going around this ellipse, but you're also getting bigger, further from the origin. So you get this sort of spiral that gets wider and wider. It goes out. And it doesn't actually start at the origin. You'll get to the origin only if you reverse time and go back to minus infinity. And then finally, if p is less than 0, then, well, I should draw the v and the w here. You'll get this sort of ellipse. It looks the same, but it spirals inwards. Inward spiral. And again, this is the only case where x of t goes to 0 as t goes to infinity. It never actually gets there, but it gets close. And this is an outward spiral. Okay. I'm going to do an example, and then we will still have roughly 25 minutes for Q&A, which I think is a little less than I had said, but should be okay. So here is an example that's quite straightforward. Suppose that we have dx dt is equal to minus x minus 2y, and dy dt is equal to 2x minus y. So in other words, as a vector, d dt of the vector xy is equal to minus 1 minus 2 to minus 1 xy. And we're calling this A. See how I packed this all up? I took the coefficients straight from here and packed it up into a matrix. But if you multiply it out, you'll see exactly that you have those two vector equations. All right, so last time we actually found the eigenvalues of A. I'm not going to do it again. Here's what we found. We found that A is equal to S R S inverse. Well, actually, we need to do the typical legal form for the. We found last time that we could write the eigenvalue. Well, I don't even remember what we found last time. Let's just do the bloody thing. All right, let's just do it. It actually turns out to be quite straightforward. You look at determinant of A minus lambda I, which is the determinant of minus 1 minus lambda, minus 2, to minus 1 minus lambda, which is minus 1 minus lambda all squared minus 2 times minus 2, which works out to lambda squared plus 2 lambda plus 5. And it turns out this equals 0 when lambda equals, so you'll have lambda plus 1 all squared plus 4. So lambda equals minus 1 plus minus 2i. Or you could use the quadratic formula. Okay, so we take lambda equals minus 1 plus 2i, and we compute kernel of A minus lambda I is equal to the kernel of the original matrix subtract minus 1 plus 2i. And you get minus 2i minus 2 to minus 2i. And we looked at this kernel last time, and we decided, OK, that's the same as the kernel of i1, 1 minus I. And this has got to be something like minus 1, comma I. This has got to be minus 1, comma I. Look, this is certainly going to work for the first line, right? You get minus I plus I. What about the second line? We get minus 1 minus I squared. But I squared is minus 1. So minus 1 and minus 1 is minus 1. Yeah, 0. Okay, so that is this. And we might as well write this as minus 1, 0 plus I times 0, 1. And this I hereby dub the V. And I dub the W. And just for yocks, I'm going to dub this P. And I'm going to dub this Q, too. Now I can write down the solution, but I'm going to do it over here. I write down the general solution, and then I'll write down the specific solution when I'll give you an initial value. I haven't actually given you the initial value yet. Okay, so what do we know? I'm going to use this equation here with the particular values of p. I'll write it out again. I know x of t because I've learnt this very diligently, is e to the pt s times the rotation matrix cosine qt minus sine qt sine qt cosine qt times s inverse times x0. Okay, so now you just have to pack it in. P, I called minus 1 because it was the real part, so I get e to the minus t. S is the matrix W, V, and W, I believe, was 0, 1, and V was minus 1, 0. Is that what I had written? Yes. Notice that the order is reversed. So I get 0, minus 1, 1, 0. I get this thing, cosine, and Q is 2. Q is 2. It's the imaginary part of the eigenvalue. So I get this. And then I will have this matrix S again, but it's the inverse of this matrix that I need. And then I'll have X0. That is the general solution. And of course, you could actually compute that big matrix. You could work that out, and you get a general solution. Remember, you cannot write down the actual solution to a differential equation without knowing the initial value. Instead, you have a general solution with some variables. Well, if indeed, let's suppose we know, suppose we're also given, as we were in the final question, that x of 0, actually, suppose when t equals 0, we have x equals 1 and y equals minus 1. That's what the exam said. Well, then, we have x of t is equal to e to the minus t, 0 minus 1, 1, 0, cosine 2t minus sine 2t, sine 2t, cosine 2t. Might as well write down the inverse of this matrix right now. So to find a 2 by 2 inverse, you compute the determinant. Quick question.
Wouldn't it be easier if you made the kernel the span of 1 or of I1 so your S would be the identity matrix?
You're getting ahead of me.
Sorry.
But you are right. We'll come back to that in a second. It's okay. You're quite correct. I just want to show you the virtue of doing the hard one first and then. Okay. There is no virtue in it. Okay, the determinant of this matrix is 1. AD minus BC. So it's all you have to do is switch the signs. So I believe you will get this. 0, 1, minus 1, 0. That's the inverse. And x0, we're given the initial data is 1, comma minus 1. So notice how I packed that in so that x equals 1 goes here and y equals minus 1 goes there. And now I just have to multiply this out. And okay, so when I say x of t, maybe I should be more like x comma y. That's how the problem language was. So you get e to the minus t. We'll keep this. We'll keep this. And we'll multiply this out. And you get minus 1, minus 1. Now we'll multiply this out. And you get minus this plus this. So sine 2t minus cosine 2t. And the bottom one will be minus sine 2t minus cosine 2t. So now that's a vector. And now you multiply it by this matrix. And you get e to the minus t. And here's the vector that we're finally looking for. You get 0 lots of this, minus 1 lots of that. So it's sine 2t plus cosine 2t. And then you get 1 lot of this plus 0 lots of that. So it's sine 2t minus cosine 2t. End of story. No, you don't substitute 0 for t. If you did substitute 0 for t, you will get the initial conditions, which is a good reality check. When you put t equals 0, you get 1. there, that's good. You get sine, you get 1 minus 1. Yes, that's the initial condition. But this is the actual solution. And if you feel compelled to write it out in gory detail, it is x is e to the minus t sine 2t plus cosine 2t. And y is the second coordinate, which is e to the minus t sine 2t minus cosine 2t. And that pair will satisfy the differential equation. X and y are both functions of t. Before I answer your question, we will go to this question. You very cleverly noticed that if we came back over here, and instead, oh, by the way, I've been a little messy here. The kernel is the span of this vector, I should have said. But if instead you had used that the kernel is the span of just I, 1. See, if you multiply this vector, well, this transposed vector times this, you get I squared plus 1 squared, which is 0. And here you get I minus I, which is 0. Then this will instead give you a V that looks like 0, 1, and a W that looks like 1, 0. And you'll find that the matrix that you get here is instead the identity. And this would also be the identity, because the inverse of the identity is the identity. And you say, wait, surely something's got to give. But actually, you can almost see in your head that if this was the identity and this was the identity, you'll still get the same answer. You'll get cosine 2t plus sine 2t, which is the correct x coordinate. And you'll get sine 2t minus cosine 2t. So you are quite right. You would have saved yourself an inverse and two matrix multiplications, which is a reasonable thing. That's just a particular fluke of this example. Most of the time, you won't get any advantage from one way or the other. But you're quite correct to spot that. And you had a question, too. Just a sec, guys. Come on. How did I see it? Well, if you have two numbers on the top row, A and B, then the kernel is going to be the span of minus B, A. You mean from here to here? Oh, I divided this by minus 2, so I got it to I1, and I divided that by 2. That's not the only way of doing it. All right. So that took a little bit longer. Okay, so I hereby declare that I am going to take a drink of water. I then declare that I'm going to erase all the boards. And then I declare that I'll have about 15 minutes to start answering your questions, unless you all leave, in which case I will stop. But next time, Thursday at 7:30, we will do only Q&A. There it is, Spring 07. Okay. Question 5. Is this the one that says, consider the sequence of real numbers an. Yes, great. So here's what it says. You are given that an plus 2 is equal to 5an plus 1 minus 6an plus 2, minus 6an. And you're given a0 equals 0, a1 equals 1. Now, it may be useful to view this as a generalized Fibonacci sequence. Okay, this is an aside. But let's say, hypothetically, I just told you that an plus 2 equals an plus 1 plus an, with, say, a1 equals 1 and a2 equals 1. What sequence would that generate? Well, this just says to get a3, you add up a1 and a2. And then to get a4, the next one, you add up a2 and a3. And then you add these two up. And you add these two up. And so that's a Fibonacci sequence. This is not the same thing, but it's the same in spirit. It's saying, okay, you start with 0, 1. To get the next number, you take 5 lots of this minus 6 of that. Then you take 5 lots of this, which is 25, minus 6 of this. Then you take 5 of that, which would be 95, minus 30. And so on. All right? So, The aim is to find a general formula for this sequence. Right? This is called a recursive formula because it tells you how to find the next one given the previous two. What you'd like to do is find an actual formula. And you can use linear algebra to do this in general, and this is what the problem's trying to say. So it says find a closed formula for an, and it gives you a hint. You may want to start by solving this discrete system. I'm just copying this out from the actual problem. Where also a0, a1 equals 0, 1. Okay, so the solution is actually here, but I'm going to explain it. So first of all, we have to be convinced that this is actually true. So why is this? So this is the hint. Why is it true? Well, this is true because if we multiply out the right matrix, the right-hand side says an plus 1 is the first coordinate, and minus 6an plus 5an plus 1 is the second coordinate. And the question is, do you agree that that equals the left-hand side? Well, you asked me the question. You see what I've done? I've taken the hint, and I've just expanded the right side. Do you agree that this vector equals this vector?
Yeah.
Right. Well, the first one's obvious. An plus 1 equals an plus 1. The second one, an plus 2, is minus 6an plus 5an plus 1, comes from the actual relation. So it's quite a clever trick to use the an plus 1 here and here with a 0, 1 in the first line. But that's, I mean, someone thought of this long time ago, and it's come down to us here today. All right. Anyway, the point is you can view this as a dynamical system. By the way, you agree also with the initial value here. A0 is 0 and A1 is 1. So let's suppose we turn this into a dynamical system. Let x of t, actually I'll call it n, let x of n be equal to an plus 1. And I'm inspired because that's the vector on the right there. And let's let the matrix A be this matrix 0, 1, minus 6, 5. The question is, what is xn plus 1? Well,
why are you using it now?
Well, just wait and see. It pops up from the hint, so I'm just you'll see why it works. Do you agree that if xn is this, an plus 1, that x of n plus 1 will be an plus 1, an plus 2? You just replace n here and here by n plus 1. Does that make sense? So what does this top equation say? The left-hand side is x of n plus 1. The right-hand side is the matrix A times xn. Okay? The whole point of these shenanigans has been to reduce this situation to a situation we're familiar with, which is the dynamical system, the discrete dynamical system. And again, the initial value, x of 0, is a0, a1. Which we know is the vector 0, 1. Okay, so the critical thing, in a sense, is that you understand how I turn the actual hint into a dynamical system merely by this. This is the only thing you have to do to convert it to a dynamical system. And then it just falls out. The left is xn plus 1, the right is a xn, and the initial condition is straightforward. Okay, any doubts or concerns about that so far? If not, you can, you know, write it down and stare at it later. And you can ask me on Thursday. Now, we have to solve this dynamical system. And we know how to do that. We diagonalize A. So the determinant of A minus lambda I is the determinant of minus lambda 1 minus 6, 5 minus lambda, which is lambda minus 5 plus 6, which is lambda squared minus 5 lambda plus 6, which is lambda minus 3 lambda plus lambda minus 2. Brilliant. So this means that x of t, or n actually, we might as well stick to the same variable, is a to the n x0, which is s ds inverse x0. Now, unfortunately, we found d, but we haven't, I'm sort of ahead of myself. Let's just get rid of that for the moment. I need to find the eigenvectors. So for lambda equals 2, let's do 3 first, what the heck. Kernel a minus 3i is the determinant of minus 3, 1, minus 6, 2. And here's my technique again. Notice this is just a the kernel. This is just a multiple of this. So the bottom gives us nothing new. It's just the span of the vector 1, 3. You see, it's just 1 times minus. I just switch these around and change the sign of one of them. It's going to work. And clearly, the bottom row is fine as well. And so for lambda equals 2, the kernel of a minus 2i is the kernel of minus 2, 1, minus 6, 3. Again, the bottom row is 3 times the top row. And this time, this is just the span of 1, 2. Right, I've just switched these two numbers around and flipped the sign of one of them. Okay, great. So now we can write down the matrix S is 1, 3, 1, 2, and D is 3, 2, diagonal. So this means that X of N is equal to what? It's equal to A to the N, X naught. This is just what I wrote before, which is S D to the N S inverse X naught. And now we can fill in the specific values. S is 1, 1, 3, 2. D to the N will be 3 to the N, 0, 0, 2 to the N. And S inverse. And then X0 we're given is 0, 1. Nope, you can't leave it like that because the problem is actually very explicit and says, I want to know the actual answer. So you have to multiply it out as well. So let's do it. The inverse, 1, 1, 3, 2. It's really easy to find the inverse. The determinant's 2 minus 3. So you get minus this matrix. Flip these two around and put minuses outside the other two. 2 by 2, straightforward. So this equals minus 2, 1, 3 minus 1. Okay, so cross that out and replace it by its actual inverse, minus 2, 1, 3, minus 1. And if you want to be really fancy, multiply these two. This is really not very good working. You just take the right column. And here you get 3 to the n and minus 2 to the n. And so if you work this out, you get 3 to the n minus 2 to the n. And here you get 3 times 3 to the n, which is 3 to the n plus 1, minus 2 times 2 to the n, which is 2 to the n plus 1. And believe it or not, this is x of n, which is supposed to be an plus 1. And we should take great comfort in knowing that not only have we proved that an is 3 to the n minus 2 to the n, we have proved also that a to the n plus 1 is 3 to the n plus 1 minus 2 to the n plus 1? Well, basically, if the first one is right, then the second one has to be right as well, or else we've screwed up majorly. But in any case, even the first row is enough to show that an is 3 to the n minus 2 to the n. And if you check that with these values right up the top here, this is 1 minus 1, this is 3 minus 2, that's 9 minus 4, this is 27 minus 8, that's the difference of the cubes, and this is 81 minus 16, which is the difference of the fourth powers. So yes, it does seem to work. Okay, this is a pretty hard question, so obviously it's taken me a little while to do. So my question is, so that's actually only the first part. But do you see how it works? Does anyone not like it? Is there any question about what I've done? All right, well, do you want me to do part B? Part B is just algebra. It has nothing to do with linear algebra. Just index rules. Or are we... part B's okay? Part B just says, show that an plus 1 squared minus an plus 2 an equals 6 to the n. And, I mean, the solution is just to plug in the formula you found in part A and do a bit of arithmetic. It has absolutely no relevance to linear algebra, but it's a fair enough question given part A. If it was by itself, I'd raise a major eyebrow and say, what the hell is that doing on here? Anyway, I think we have time for one more, so you can go ahead. Number 4. Okay, we don't really have a lot of time for one more, but we started a little late, so. Okay, so this is the one that says true or false. Yes?
No.
I thought 407. Oh, that's quiz. Never mind. 407. Is that the January 2008? Okay.
Oh, sorry,
406. That's the one that says, if I'm not mistaken, let T be a linear transformation. Okay. Well, I'll write it up. You're given the following. T of 3, 1 equals 2 minus 4. And T of 1, 1 equals 0, 2. Okay. And it says, A, find T of E1 and T of E2. And I'll write up the other questions as we go along. Okay. So here's what you do. We know that T of 3, 1 is this. So let's suppose the matrix of T is A. It's just easier to use A. So A of 3, 1 is 2 of minus 4. Whereas A of 1, 1 is 0, 2. So this equation here expresses both the facts all in one matrix equation. Okay? A of 3, 1, that vector is this vector, and A of the 1, 1 column is 0, 2. That's how this matrix multiplication works. So this says that the matrix A of T is equal to 2, 0, minus 4, 2 times the inverse on the right of this matrix. You have to be careful to do it on the right. I actually made this mistake embarrassingly in one of my review sessions. I was a little careless, so don't do it. So we compute the inverse. The determinant is 3 minus 1, which is 2, so we'll have a half. Switch these two around and put minus signs in front of the other. And if you work this out, you get the matrix 1 minus 3 minus 1, 5. That just actually has to be multiplied out. All right, so what can we conclude? You tell me. Since you asked. Okay, do you see what we've done so far? Okay, so what's T of 1. Yeah, it's A times 1, 0, which is the first column of A, which is 1, comma, minus 3. And similarly, T of E2, I'm not using these vectors, is the second column. I think that's the easiest way to do part A. Any questions about that? I only have time to do B and C, and then that's going to be it. We'll do more on Thursday. Linear algebra questions take a long time. It always takes longer than I think. Somehow the calculus questions are quicker to do. All right, part B says, what is T of X for X equals X1, X2 transpose? Well, that's pretty straightforward. T of X, we've already done all the work, is AX, which is 1 minus 1 minus 3, 5, X1, X2, that's the transpose there. And then explicitly we multiply it out and we find the first coordinate is X1 minus X2 and the second coordinate is 3X1 plus 5X2. So that is the difference between a matrix and a function, is that this is actually T of X. This is an explicit multiplied out formula that you don't need to know a matrix multiplication. This is T of 3, 8. Is 3 minus 8, which is minus 5 here, minus 9 plus 40 would be 31 there. So it gives you the actual formula. And then C says find the matrix representing T with respect to the basis, which is 1, 2, 2, 1. Well, there's a general way of finding this. Yeah, this is otherwise known as the B matrix of T. And so the general idea is you let S be equal to 1, 2, 2, 1. Then the B matrix of T, which I'll call B, is given by S inverse AS. And that is the different order from the diagonalization version. And that is because in the diagonalization, you write A is S DS inverse. So actually, it's the D that we're looking for in this case, although it won't be diagonal. So just be very careful about that. The B matrix of S is not the standard form. It's the opposite, because you're actually A would be S BS inverse. So all you have to do is compute this 1, 2, 2, 1 inverse times this A matrix we found, 1 minus 1 minus 3, 5, times 1, 2, 2, 1. And again, you take the determinant of this as minus a third, and you can compute this out, and I will leave it to you to multiply this all out, and you find that you get 5 minus 1 minus 3, 1. Okay, so that's pretty similar to the original matrix, actually. It's a bit of bizarrely similar, but it's not the same. I say similar, it's not actually similar matrix. It's just quite close to that. But that's what I found it to be. Now, okay, that's the solution. Suppose you had a few extra minutes, and we don't have a lot for the video, but anyway. Suppose we had a few extra minutes. I want to do a reality check that this is indeed the B matrix. Okay, so I'll show you how to check your work if you have extra time. Because, you know, you just come up with this. How do you know it's right? Check. If there's any justice in the world, then when you apply this matrix to the vector 1, 0, it should have some sort of meaning. So what sort of meaning should it have? Well, what's T of 1, 2? We go back up to the original function of t, which we found in part b. And we get the coordinate of x single component is minus 1. And the second coordinate is minus 3 plus 10, which is 7. Well, so what? Yeah, but you need to know what this is in terms of V1 and V2. But you see, according to this, if we're correct, we should be able to say this equals 5 V1 minus 3 V2. Is that true? 5 minus 6 is negative 1. 10 minus 3 is 7. It's like magic. Okay? I just want to show you, you have to agree with this, even though you may not see how I got it. You agree that t of 1, 2, if you go up to this formula here, and you plug in 1, 2, you get negative 1, 7. That's what you get. And then I took this new matrix that's supposed to be the answer, and I just took 5 V1, which is the first column, minus 3 V2. And I assert that's true. Let's see what this actually says. This says T V1, where V1 is this, and V2 is this. So this says T V1 is 5 V1 minus 3 V2. And I bet you if you compute T V2, which involves 2, 1 instead, you will find that this is equal to minus V1 plus V2. And I got that by reading the coefficients of here. And just for yocks, I'll show you. These are the actual computations. This one gives this, and I'll show you t of 2, 1. If I plug it in, I get 2 minus 1 is 1, and minus 6 plus 5 is minus 1. And this is supposedly equal to minus 1 V1, V1 being 1, 2, plus V2, which is 2, 1. And yes, if you add that up, you do get this. Okay, so what I want you to understand is, if I told you that a transformation T satisfied these two, you should immediately be able to write down the B matrix, which is almost just the matrix of coefficients. It's the transpose of it. It has to be the transpose. Okay, so this check, we checked explicitly that and that hold, just by plugging in the V1 and the V2. Okay, so for my actual check, the best thing to do would be to mentally transpose this, say, well, to check we need this and this to be true, and then plug in both sides and see that they work out. And that works. You like that, huh? Okay, you don't like that, you just don't care about it. Okay, I think we're done for today, so I'll probably see you on Thursday. I'll be here anyway.